be impossible to conceive a fixed-wing aircraft that could take or hold land without a run over a long stretch of concrete. The faster and heavier the aircraft, the longer and stronger the runway needs. But in a few years, runways will be obsolete. Military aircraft of the future will be able to operate from advanced bases such as this, using small sectional pads capable of being rapidly assembled or dismantled and taken to and from the site by air or road transport. A base of this kind will be set up in fields or mountainous country and quickly prepared for operation. The flexibility of strike aircraft will be immeasurably increased. The first logical step toward these aircraft of the future is the short SC-1 vertical takeoff and landing research aircraft, which is being developed to explore problems of stability and control during hovering and transition. Power for forward flight is supplied by a single Rolls-Royce RB-108 jet engine mounted in the rear of the fuselage. The intake for this engine is at the base of the fin. To provide vertical lifting power, four RB-108 are mounted in a central engine bay. The lifting engines, here seen from below, are mounted in crosswise pairs. Each pair can swivel fore and aft through 30 degrees and can thus be moved to give forward thrust of takeoff or a braking effect before landing. To provide stability in hovering flight and during transition, four air jet nozzles are installed, one each at wingtips, nose and tail. This view of a nozzle fitted at the nose of the aircraft shows the movable shutter which covers the flow of air. Both this nozzle and the one at the rear can be rotated to provide control of yaw. A gyro auto-stabilizer control system, duplicated for safety, governs the operation of the nozzle shutter and can also operate the aerodynamic surface. With his left hand, the pilot operates the lever controlling the throttle for the lift engine. The propulsion engine is controlled either by a conventional throttle or a twist grip on the lift engine lever, while the stick monitors the auto-stabilizer. All undercarriage wheels can caster. During conventional flight, the main wheels are kept forward close under the center of gravity. For vertical landing, the pilot selects wheels back to give greater ground stability. The aircraft made its first taxiing runs at Belfast in December 1956. Later, the aircraft was taken to England, and on April 2, 1957, began its flight development program at Boscombe Downs using conventional takeoff and landing techniques. For its first flight. The ability to operate as a conventional aircraft has greatly facilitated the development of vertical takeoff itself. Uses a braking parachute to shorten its run. This is a special test gantry built up from Bainbridge components in which the SC-1 made its first vertical takeoff on Whit Monday 1958 at Belfast. Initially tethered to the floor of the platform, and for this reason could not rise more than a foot. preliminary tests tested in this way, it was clear that the aircraft could be taken off under complete control. The next stage was the start of full-scale hovering trials in the gantry. For these tests, the tethers were removed, but the aircraft's zone of flight within the gantry superstructure was determined by a system of cables. These, with the vertical pulley, did not assist or support the aircraft in any way, but were provided purely as a safety measure. Thus, during these trials, the aircraft was virtually flying free. In all, some 8 hours of hovering were completed by a long series of flights, each lasting only a few minutes. These periods of hovering, though brief when considered in terms of conventional flight, were quite long in the field of the pure jet-powered vertical takeoff and landing. In the ultimate flight plan, vertical takeoff and hovering last only a fraction of a minute before transition. Throughout the trial, the aircraft attitude was completely stable under the control of the auto stabilizer system. Strong winds, as the sound, had little effect on stability when hovering. Tests in winds of over 30 miles an hour became a matter of routine, and on one occasion, gusts of well over 40 miles an hour were recorded. Soon the chief test pilot, Mr. Tom Booksmith, was quite ready to begin free flight. For free flight trials, which began in October 1958, a small platform was used for takeoff. This is a low portable type, built up in sections, which can be laid out in any clear space, even on soft ground. For the SC-1's first free flight. Now comes a really exciting moment for the test pilot as he prepares to take the aircraft up completely free for the first time. The aircraft made a completely successful vertical takeoff. Under the power of the four vertical lift engines, it lifted clear off the platform and then rose straight up to a height of several feet before slowly nosing forward over the runway. The auto-stabilizer system was working faultlessly. Although the propulsion engine was not used in these trials, a forward thrust component from the lift engine was achieved by slightly tilting the aircraft forward. At the end of this flight, the aircraft landed on a soft turf of a football pitch. Some observers had believed that there was a possibility that the turf might disintegrate under the blast of the jet. But short engineers were quite sure that this would not happen. And here the aircraft had seen heading towards the football pitch and hovering in preparation for landing. As soon as the aircraft had landed, the lift engines were shut off. The only effect on the turf was a slight scorching of the grass beneath the engine bay. With conventional flight and vertical takeoff now successfully accomplished, it remains only to link the two to make the transition which will mark the climax of the development of the short SC-1.